Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to this, the third meeting in 2016 of the Economy, Energy and Tourism Committee. Can I welcome all members, welcome our witnesses and visitors in the gallery, and can I remind everyone please to turn off or at least turn to silent their mobile phones and other electronic devices so they don't interfere with the committee's work. We have no apologies this morning, but I've had intimation from both Patrick Harvey and John Lamont that they will need to leave briefly during the item four on the agenda to attend to other parliamentary business. Item one on the agenda, are members content that we agree to take item five on the Enterprise Bill Legislative Consent Memorandum and item six, a discussion on evidence heard at today's meeting in private?
Agreed.
That's agreed, thank you. Item two, can I ask members if they are content to delegate to the convener responsibility for arranging for the SPCB to pay under Rule 12.4.3 any expenses of witnesses attending forthcoming evidence sessions in relation to our inquiry into social enterprises and employee-owned businesses. That's agreed. Thank you. Item three on the agenda, we are taking evidence from the Scottish Government on the Enterprise Bill, UK parliamentary legislation and a legislative consent memorandum in relation thereto, and I'd like to welcome Fergus, Ewing, Minister for Business, Energy and Tourism, who's joined by Oonagh, Deputy Director, Enterprise and Cities, Geoff Owenson, who's Senior Policy Official, Finance Pay Policy, and Stuart, Foubister, Divisional Solicitor at the Scottish Government. Welcome to you all. Minister, do you want to say something to introduce this?
Yes, thank you very much, Convener. I'm very grateful for today's opportunity to address the committee in respect of the motion lodged by the Deputy First Minister on the 9th December last year. The UK Enterprise Bill was introduced in the House of Lords on the 16th of September and is progressing through the UK Parliament. It includes a wide range of measures aimed at promoting economic growth, and the UK government expects it to remove what it regards as unnecessary impediments to business. The majority of the provisions within the bill are reserved to the UK Parliament. What we are concerned with today are those that fall within devolved competence of this Parliament and which require an LCM to allow the UK Parliament to legislate for these matters. The LCM covers two areas, establishing a small business commissioner and capping public sector exit payments. I briefly outline each of these areas. The UK government intend to establish a small business commissioner as a statutory appointment with powers to offer advice, guidance and a complaint service to small businesses. The UK government's aim is to tackle poor payment practice across the UK where a small business is subject to unfavourable contract conditions yet is keen to maintain that vital commercial relationship with a larger company. Extending the provisions to Scotland places Scottish businesses on an equal footing with those across the UK. Payment practices that disadvantage small businesses are a common complaint, and the Small Business Commissioner offers an opportunity to redress these issues that are a challenge for many of Scotland's small businesses who do business across the UK. My officials are in discussion with the UK Government to ensure that Scottish interests and delivery processes are represented as UK government developed regulations for operational procedures. The proposal, Convener, is seen as generally welcomed by the small business community, adding to existing mechanisms. The provisions fall within devolved competence as they affect business support policy, and the consent of the Scottish Parliament will therefore be required to extend the measure to Scotland. Secondly, on capping public sector exit payments. The second measure outlined in the LCM is to provide regulation-making powers for Scottish ministers in respect of the cap and public sector exit payments. UK government intends to limit public sector exit payments to a maximum of £95,000. The measure provides for Scottish ministers to make similar regulations in respect of devolved Scottish public bodies. It would be for Scottish ministers to determine if and how they want to take forward such proposals. My officials have sought views across the Scottish public sector and trades unions on this measure. Most respondents were in favour to ensure that the proper consideration could be given to Scottish circumstances should there be any prospect of such a cap being introduced, but commented that the UK proposals were overly prescriptive. Ministers therefore have an idea of the ranges of issues and concerns and have not made any decision as to how the cap might apply to devolved Scottish public bodies. We have committed to consult fully before making regulations to enact the power, including on such issues as exemptions from the cap and delegation of decision-making powers. In his correspondence with the UK government in October 2015, the DFM indicated his support of these measures subject to 2 points. First, that £95,000 is not specified on the bill, as Scottish ministers want to have full flexibility over the powers to set the level of any cap from the outset, as well as to vary it. And secondly, that the delegated authority is extended to allow Scottish ministers to make regulations around the capping of public sector exit payments in relation to civil servants working for the Scottish Government. Both of these revisions would be more consistent with the devolution of responsibilities for public sector pay, terms and conditions and exit payments. HMT officials finally offered a response last Friday. They are clear that Scottish ministers could determine their own level of exit payment caps, and if they chose a different figure, this could be set out in the Scottish regulations at the outset. From a presentational point of view, it may have been better if there had been something expressed in the bill, but legally the position is fine and we are content. In relation to the issue about Scottish civil servants and the Scottish administration being covered by the UK regulations, whilst Cabinet Office have already delegated authority to Scottish ministers in respect of terms and conditions and voluntary severance, the powers to make regulations in relation to those civil servants remains with UK ministers. HMT officials have not said whether they do intend to provide this delegation now, though it would remain something that could be done at any time. We will continue to press them on the issue. The potential benefits to the Scottish public sector of ministers holding regulation-making powers are such that we would want to progress this LCM, even if UK ministers were not content to agree the points raised in the DFM's letter. The Scottish Government recognises the current position on voluntary severance may not always provide the best outcome for the Scottish public sector. The powers proposed under the bill provide sufficient flexibility to allow them to be adapted to suit the Scottish public sector landscape. Once the regulation-making power is vested in Scottish ministers, it would be for Scottish ministers to determine if and how they want to take forward such proposals. This provision affects the executive competence of Scottish ministers, and the consent of the Scottish Parliament will therefore be required to extend the measure to Scotland. Finally, in the Green Investment Bank, an amendment was introduced to the bill on the 14th of October last year to repeal the Green Investment Bank provisions of the Enterprise and Regulatory Reform Act 2013 in support of privatisation. Given the lack of consultation or reassurance on this privatisation process, and the UK view that no Scottish legislative consent was required, the in-principle support offered to the UK government in early October for the Enterprise Bill was rescinded until further notice. Following constructive dialogue between UK and Scottish governments, reassurances were received from the Secretary of State for Business and from Lord Smith of Kelvin, Chair of the Green Investment Bank, in relation to protecting the green purpose of the bank and the importance of the bank's Edinburgh headquarters and employees. All correspondence on this matter have been made available to Parliament. On this basis, the strategic decision was taken to not to further pursue an LCM in relation to the Green Investment Bank amendments, and the previously expressed in principle agreement to legislative consent was reinstated. Thank you.
Thank you, Minister, for that explanation. I've got two members who have got questions I want to ask. Just before I come to them, if I can just ask a couple of questions in relation to what you've said. Firstly, in relation to the Small Business Commissioner, clearly that is something, from what you've said, the Scottish Government are supportive of. Can you tell us how much that's likely to cost the Scottish Government, given it looks like the costs of this are to be shared between UK and Scottish Government?
I have a figure here somewhere which I read yesterday evening and which I suspect will be produced in front of me in very short order. I think the cost, to be serious, will be relatively modest. The problem is very, very substantial, and we welcome this step, but we don't think it will be enough. We do not think it will be enough. Meeting with the FSB, Glasgow region, in a very cordial engagement late last year, many of us here who were there were left with the clear impression that late payment is an endemic and unaddressed problem in many respects in the UK. And there's a very strong feeling that many large companies, and I'm not going to name any of them, but do take advantage of their relative strength in the bargaining position and wait many, many, many months before payment is made, and moreover, that many small businesses feel constrained in speaking out for fear of losing custom, where they seem to be, putting it bluntly, troublemakers, as perceived from the large business point of view. So this is a very serious problem, one that the Scottish Government feels it doesn't have sufficient powers to legislate entirely on itself, although I should say we have, and this is a very important convener, and I have been involved in this in some respects, taking steps to ensure that so far as the public sector is concerned, that the payment of public sector to small businesses and businesses in general is something that's conducted in a far more satisfactory way. And the evidence we have on that, if you're interested in, we can share with you, because it's an ongoing debate. We need constantly to revisit that to make sure it's operating properly. Yes, the figure in my cranial area was £90,000 to £100,000. Those are the estimated costs that we expect at the moment to be attributable to the cost of establishing a small business commissioner. That does seem to me to be surprisingly modest, convener, I have to say. So I'm going to ask that we, after this meeting, review that to see if, in fact, it is sort of future-proof. And if there are any further points on that, we will come back to you.
But sorry, just so I'm clear, the £90,000 to £100,000 is the Scottish Government's share of the cost. Is it presumably the overall cost is much higher?
Yes, that's indeed. I thought that's what you meant. We have about 7% of the total of small businesses in the UK, with an estimated 7% of predicted businesses likely to use the Commissioner. The UKG have indicated it will meet the cost of establishing the Commissioner. Should that position change, the estimated running costs may be around £90,000 to £110,000. And that's based on the analysis of the UK government consultation and analysis. As I say, that figure looks to me to be small, because if 7% of small businesses complain to the commissioner, that will be a lot of complaints. And I'm not quite sure how they expect all such a large volume of complaints actually to be handled, other than in a very cursory, high-level way. And were that to happen, I suspect that we may get the situation of there being complaints about the complaints. But let's not be too gloomy today. Let's say that in principle this is a good idea, and that is why we are supporting it. In principle and on the face of it, it could have the possibility to tackle a problem, and therefore, as an optimist, I support it, and the Scottish Government, a cabinet, more to the point, has supported it.
Okay, but sorry, can I just press you, just so I'm clear about this, the £90,000 to £100,000. Is that the Scottish Government's share of the cost, or is that the total cost?
It's the Scottish Government.
It's the estimated annual running cost for Scotland may be around that amount.
Right, okay. So it's your share?
Yes.
Okay. And I've just got one question on the issue of the capping the public sector exit payments. How many, over the past year, for example, how many Scottish public sector payments would have been made which would have exceeded that cap of 95,000?
Well, again, convener, somewhat late last night after coming from a trip to Caithness and North Sutherland, yesterday I did read a figure which is going to be presented to me shortly. But could I say that as officials provide me with this figure, I hope, to be serious, this is a very serious, significant problem. I think we all recognise that there have been some serious instances of payments which seem to members of the public and members of Parliament to be excessive. I'm not going to go into any examples. I think that would be an abuse of my position. But we don't really need to think too far or too long. And therefore, this is a legitimate and serious area of concern. And therefore, I very much welcome the fact that the Scottish Government has decided to take a Scottish approach, and that the UK Government, to be fair, has largely cooperated in principle with that. I think that's really all to be welcomed. What we're not doing today is making a decision about what that decision would be. That would be entirely wrong. I mean, that would prejudge entirely a debate. But the need to take some kind of action, I think, is recognised and manifest. So I think, in principle, this is something that we entirely support as necessary. I did make reference to the preliminary consultation which we'd carried out, which did indicate that the view of setting one figure was perhaps overly prescriptive. And that is a view that plainly we would have to look at seriously. Local government made specific points, as perhaps is not unexpected. But I can give you some initial provisional
Scottish Government figures.
Information from the Scottish Government that out of 238 applications received for such payments in 2014-15, there were 22 cases which would have been affected by a cap set at £95,000 in some way. So what I will undertake to do, if it would help, because I appreciate, you know, any computations, figures, statistics are complex and they need to be seen in the round. So we will, if that's acceptable, write to you confirming the level of the nature of the issue here, but it looks as if it's 22 out of 238 or somewhere under 10%, a significant, not an enormous, but nonetheless a significant number of individual cases where on the face of it, the payment, the reward, would have been in excess of the figure of £95,000, which I think most people would see as a very large payment indeed.
Okay, thank you. Right, I've got a few members who want to come in. Patrick Harvey?
Thank you. Good morning. Still on the issue of public sector exit payments, the end of paragraph 15 of the memorandum reads, trade unions have been more forceful in asking the Scottish Government to reject the UK Government's proposals. And you touched on this, Minister, in your opening remarks. I wonder if you could just expand on what the nature of those objections were and how the Scottish Government responded to them.
Well, I'm not cited on that. So I'll ask Mr. Owenson,
yeah.
I think, to expand on that. And if he's not able to do so at the moment, we can certainly write to you with some more details. Mr. Owenson.
Yeah. Well, the time constraint imposed by the UK Government timetable prevented any formal consultation. So what we did in about late autumn last year was a very quick feedback exercise. And the public bodies and unions and so on that we approached understood that it was a very quick and dirty, if you like. Most of the respondents were in favour of ministers taking relevant powers to ensure the proper consideration could be given. Many respondents commented that the proposals were overly prescriptive and that there were other routes for setting voluntary early severance and early retirement payments at an appropriate level. Local government has indicated that they would wish to continue discretion over their own arrangements, and the trade unions have been more forceful in asking the Scottish Government to reject the UK proposals. So, I mean, as I say, it was a very quick and dirty exercise. It was over a period of 2-3 weeks, I think. You know, these are the information that, you know, we're fed back to the Scottish ministers, and at that moment they're still obviously considering what, you know, what, how they want to take forward these, if, whether they want to take these regulations.
Okay, well, I acknowledge that, you know, this may come up if a future decision is made to use these powers, but given that we've not heard anything more than what's written in the paragraph in front of us, I think it would be helpful to hear something in writing about the nature of the objections that were raised, mm-hmm. and how they were responded to by the government.
Well, we'll certainly consider that. But I mean, I think it's been made clear already, both by myself and Mr. Owenson, that the initial consultation was of necessity a pretty quick exercise carried out, not the thorough consultation that I think this issue merits. And therefore, I'm not really sure we're able to say much more than we've done. And also, to be fair, I think the trade unions, with whom we work extremely closely in all matters, are very capable of speaking for themselves and should have the opportunity to do so if they so wish.
Thank you very much, Minister. You referred rightly to the prospect of privatisation of the Green Investment Bank as one of the significant aspects of this bill, and I think you explained the concerns you had both about a privatised bank ceasing to focus on green investment priorities and about the possibility of that bank moving away from Edinburgh. You've said that you received reassurances that satisfied you. Can you tell us what steps would have followed had you not been satisfied with those reassurances?
Well, that is a hypothetical question. So, you know, that's not where we are. I mean, we were very concerned about two matters principally, and one matter of principle. We didn't agree with the privatisation of the Green Investment Bank. Full stop. Second, on matters of operation, we wanted to make sure that it would remain a green investment bank, not just become an investment bank. And secondly, of course, that its headquarters and associated jobs would be retained in Edinburgh, and that in itself is, you know, a subject of some controversy. So What assurances did we get? Reassurances on the green purpose were offered by the Secretary of State for Business, Innovation and Skills, Sajid Javid MP, in a letter of the 3rd of November. A subsequent letter from Lord Smith of Kelvin of the Green Investment Bank on the 12th of November reaffirms the GIB's board's continued commitment to retaining the headquarters and associated jobs in Edinburgh following privatisation. Now, whilst these responses that I've briefly summarised and which I believe are available, as I've said, in the Scottish Parliament, do not alleviate all risk following privatisation, it seems to be a pretty reasonable and helpful response from both parties, and it does give us reassurances from the UK government in areas of importance to Scotland. So it was really on the common sense basis that of the responses we received in good faith from Sajid Javid and from Lord Smith of Kelvin, someone of the highest repute, that we felt that the two very serious issues that we raised, Mr. Lewis MacDonald rightly raises, were satisfactorily dealt with. And in a situation of trust and in respect in dealing with governments, we felt that the conclusion we reached at that point was one which we reached with justification. And we will, of course, continue to monitor this extremely carefully.
Thank you. I have seen the correspondence between Sajid Javid and John Swinney and also the letter from Lord Smith of Kelvin. And Sajid Javid on the 3rd of November was keen to point out that seeking agreement on a voluntary basis from new shareholders was, quote, the most we can do to secure this. In other words, to secure a green priority approach. It is simply not open to us, the UK government, to impose more binding conditions that require future owners of Green Investment Bank to act in a particular way. So I'm keen to understand, given that the Minister in charge, the Secretary of State for Business, Innovation and Skills, was keen to point out the limits of assurance he could give you. And also, he did the same very much so around the issue of the headquarters remaining in Edinburgh. It is important to recognise that there is only so much government can do in this matter, is what Sajid Javid said, and Lord Smith simply expressed his own personal commitment to Edinburgh and his enthusiasm for staying in Edinburgh. But given the limited nature of those assurances, is the Minister satisfied that actually either of those outcomes is guaranteed much beyond the next few months?
Well, I think, as I've already said, the reassurances were couched in such terms as it affords us reasonably to reach the conclusion justifying the agreement to the LCM. And these assurances have been provided. I think the main thing is in good faith. As for guarantees, well, guarantees are not things that's easy to come by in life, in government. And I do recall that in my days as a lawyer, it was banks that were providing the guarantees. And they had some difficulties not so long ago, as I recall. So I think that it's reasonable to rely upon the assurances given in good faith by Lord Smith and Sajid Javid. I think it's fair to point out that, I mean, the decision to privatise is not one that we support. It's not one that we can prevent. It's not within our power to prevent. I mean, you know, had the constitutional decision in Scotland been different, then there would have been a different dynamic. But that's not the case, and therefore power rests in London, and we cannot prevent decisions being taken by the UK government. Now, we have to act in a respectful way towards the people that we deal with, and that's correct, and that's what we do. I think the Deputy First Minister acted entirely appropriate here, and he obtained assurances which are sufficient in their terms. The more important thing, really, frankly, in relation to this whole area is that green renewable industry and investment continues. And perhaps the more substantial question is, of course, the concerns that we have about the fiscal machete having been taken to the destruction of the renewable industry in Scotland and the UK. That really gets to the heart of the issue, and perhaps is something which is of more direct relevance to the stability and confidence of investors in the green sector. And I have, if you like, a grandstand seat here because I deal with investors from governments and public companies, both in the UK and Firth of Scotland, whose confidence in the investing in the sector has, I think it's fair to say without exaggeration, been undermined by the exercise of said fiscal machete over the last year since the UK election. That perhaps really is the very serious issue, because that determines the viability of the investments for which, if you like, the Green Investment Bank was established to enable.
We're here, with respect, we're here to consider a legislative consent motion, and that answer brings me back to my first question, which you dismissed as hypothetical. Given that new shareholders could change the chair, change the chief executive, relocate the headquarters, and resile from voluntary agreements with the UK government, and given that there seemed to be some difference of view between the Scottish government and the UK government about whether Scottish legislative consent was required to the amendments relating to the Green Investment Bank, did you come to a conclusion about whether a legislative consent motion was required in relation to those amendments or not?
Well, you know, Convener, I have quite enough reality to deal with in my working day without having to spend time in conjecture on hypotheses. So, you know, I'm afraid that, fairly or unfairly, I'm going to decline the opportunity to start to get involved in that. What I would say, and I did read it out in my opening statement, Convener, is that the initial view that we took was not to agree. Not to agree. It was only after the assurances were sought and obtained on the key points, about which I've been entirely open and candid in these unscripted remarks. It was only after that, for the reasons I've stated, that we agreed. So I think the answer to your question is that initially we said, no, we are not happy with this unless we get assurances that it will continue to be headquartered in Scotland and that the green nature of its activities will continue. Now, I think that that was a reasonable course, and you know, I entirely accept Mr. MacDonald might want me to say, you know, what our position would have been if things had panned out differently, but since they didn't, I don't propose to do so.
I'm simply trying to establish whether you saying you didn't agree could have had force or not.
Well, you know, I think I, with respect, Convener, I do think I have answered the point in the way that I've chosen to.
Okay. Mr. Brodie wants to go on. Just before I do that, Minister, I have to say your comments about the fiscal machete seem rather bizarre, given that the subsidy cut I think you're referring to applied to onshore wind projects, which the Green Investment Bank, as you well know, has never supported in terms of its business plan and has no plans to support. But I wonder if the fiscal machete would also apply to your government's plans to hit the renewable sector with an additional £10 million tax grab by bringing their projects under the remit of the business rates regime for the first time.
It's not simply the reduction, the elimination actually of the incentive support system for onshore wind. It's the fact that particular a form of renewables was by experts adjudged beyond peradventure.
But with respect to this, we're talking about the Green Investment Bank. The Green Investment Bank was very clear when the Green Investment Bank was set up. The Green Investment Bank was not set up to support onshore wind projects. That's never part of its business plan and never part of its forward plan. So why are you bringing in a totally irrelevant matter into this discussion?
Well, with respect, Convener, I appreciate this is becoming a political discussion, but I want to respond. And I'll tell you what the response is. That I know that great many of the companies that were absolutely appalled by the UK's decision to scrap the least expensive.
But it's nothing to do with the Green Investment Bank.
I'm coming on to that.
Irrelevant.
Well, you know, if I may have the opportunity to complete the point, many investors in onshore wind are also investors in offshore wind. The undermining of confidence in one leads to a counterpart risk and, in some cases, actuality of undermining confidence in them all. The argument is, if a government pulls the rug from our feet in one area where incentives have been promised, then what is to prevent them from so doing in other areas? Now, I've heard this argument from a great many companies, Convener, who are involved in offshore wind. And therefore, I think the way I put it was not an over-exaggeration. But, you know, I do understand though not some of your colleagues, take a very condemnatory view of onshore wind.
Okay, and what view are these same companies taking of your government's tax grab of £10 million a year on renewable energy projects?
Well, the business rates measures were introduced by Mr. Swinney of an entirely different level of range and scale, and will affect existing businesses that are contributing successfully. And I do not believe that that measure is a comparator of that order. We are not comparing apples with apples here.
Okay, Chair Brody.
Thank you. I have two very brief questions. Good morning, Minister and ladies and gentlemen. Just on the point of the Green Investment Bank, I mean, there's no assurance really in Sajid David's letter that he can control anything in terms of the privatisation or the retention of the headquarters in Edinburgh. It's a shame that, of course, major shareholders in the new company are not indeed employees in Edinburgh, and I have a concern as to what may happen with senior members of the Green Investment Bank in terms of their migration to the new company. Is there any caveat in there that says there will be that will be looked at? We've talked about the capping. That doesn't stop, as I say, the migration of senior members of the Green Investment Bank currently joining the new company or owning shares in the new company. That's the first question. The second question is, some 3 years ago, I wrote to the DFM as a European reporter on this committee regarding a meeting I'd had with the European Commissioner on small businesses with a view to creating a small business commissioner in Scotland. The basis of that was that the relationship between the UK and Europe wasn't particularly friendly. I have no reason to feel that that will change. But the basis of putting forward that suggestion was that there was no meaningful application to help small businesses from the European COSME Small Business Fund, which amounts to 2.3 billion euros up the period 2020. Again, I see nothing in the enterprise bill that will address that, and I see nothing in the LCM that indicates what a supportive, I'll put that in inverted commas, supportive role there might be from a small business or a sub-small business commissioner in Scotland.
Well, regarding the second point, I think not for the first time, Mr. Brodie has raised an interesting point, and one which I hadn't perhaps anticipated would form part of the debate this morning. So I think, out of fairness in him, we will go away and look at it carefully, particularly if the reference to the scale of the potential funding involved from Europe. I mean, I can say more generally that the officials dealing with European development funding are very attuned to the possibilities of and the need to use available funding to assist small businesses, and that is very much part of our plan or programme for the next wave of funding, and that's something of which I've taken an interest in, and are bringing together Scottish Government officials to discuss with the Federation of Small Business and other bodies, as rightly so. But we will take away, if I may, Convener, Mr. Brodie's point and come back to him on that. Regarding
I apologise. Just when I saw something, I decided to raise the question this morning.
No need to apologise. You know, we're all working as a team here, sort of. So, and I have a little team here, so I'm going to pass to this member of the team, Stuart Foubister, to answer the first question.
On Mr. Brodie's first point, I don't think there is anything in the correspondence. I'm not aware of anything in the correspondence about guarantees for senior staff. The point I would make is that there isn't a separate company being created. Privatisation will retain the same company, same legal entity, so there's no automatic conclusion that there's a need for transfer of senior staff or anything like that.
Or shareholdings.
Well, shareholdings would need transferred in privatisation, yeah.
Okay, thank you very much. We are very short question, sorry.
Yeah. I'm not going to ask you a hypothetical question, and I'm not going to ask you something that's not on the agenda, I work for the Royal Bank of Scotland. I get made redundant with the Royal Bank a number of years ago. So can I ask that, do you honestly believe the assurances that you've been given in regards to the Green Investment Bank?
I think I have covered the approach we have taken. And, you know, I think it is an approach that is correct, and part of the reason why it's correct is that it was given by a cabinet secretary in the UK government, And it's given by Lord Smith, someone of unchallenged repute in his personal dealings. Mr. MacDonald is quite rightly, and I think Mr. Lyle now, is pointing to things that could happen in the future. And I'm not, if you like, challenging that we are not able to predict with absolute clarity and certainty what the future may hold. But as of here and now, as in the government, as the nature of the way in which we take decisions, you know, we take decisions taking account of issues such as the nature of the assurances and the persons from whom they are received. And I think that the decisions we have taken are the right decisions for the reasons that that I have said. And without casting any aspersions on bankers, I mean, they haven't actually been provided by bankers.
Thank you.
Okay, if there are no other questions, I thank the Minister and his officials for coming along, and the committee will consider in private session shortly our response to the LCM. Well, I now have a short suspension to allow a changeover of witnesses. Thank you very much. We are moving on to item four on the agenda, and we are taking evidence from the Longannet Task Force. I would just say two things, process issues. Just first of all, John Lamont has had to leave us to attend to parliamentary business elsewhere, and Patrick Harvey is having to leave us shortly to attend to parliamentary business elsewhere, but they may come and go in the course of the meeting. So just so you're aware. They're not storming out because of something you've said. Well, that might yet. Thank you all for coming. I apologise to witnesses too. We are running a little bit late this morning. But we have until about 11:30 for this session, and the committee was keen to hear from the Longannet Task Force. I should declare an interest. I am actually a member of the Longannet Task Force myself. The committee was keen to hear from the task force about the work of the task force, how it's going to take its work forward in supporting the workforce at Longannet, given we know closure is now imminent. What the wider plans are for the Fife economy and how the economic hole that will be created by the loss of Longannet can be filled. And also, I think we want to get an understanding more generally of the value of these task forces. I mean, I think I currently sit on three Scottish Government task forces, and I think we're keen to understand, you know, what the purpose of a task force is and what the objectives are behind it. Now, I appreciate there are, we have six of you here, so it's quite a large panel, so please don't feel you all have to try and answer every single question that's asked, otherwise we might be here for some time. But maybe I should just start by introducing you all, starting from the left. We've Stephen Boyd, who is Assistant Secretary of STUC, Hugh Finlay, who's Generation Director at Scottish Power, Callum McLean, who's Pace Manager at Skills Development Scotland, Councillor Leslie Laird, Deputy Leader of Fife Council, Fergus Ewing, of course, Minister for Business, Energy and Tourism at the Scottish Government, and Danny Cusick, who is Senior Director, Food and Drink, Tourism and Textiles, and Location Director for Fife at Scottish Enterprise. So welcome to you all. Now, I think, Minister, do you want to say something by way of an introductory statement?
Yes, I do have a statement. Thanks, Convener. I welcome the opportunity to address the committee on the matter of ongoing support for workers, businesses and communities affected by the premature closure of Longannet Power Station. It's a timely opportunity given the electricity production at Longannet is due to cease in just over 2 months' time. Against a backdrop of concerns for energy security linked to shrinking margins across the GB electricity system, particularly the concerns for the consequences for Scotland of losing future power generation at Longannet, the EET Committee has recently completed an inquiry into security of supply. The Scottish Government's view of energy security and energy policy is much less sanguine than the view presented in the committee's report, published on 26th of October, plugged in, switched on, charged up, ensuring Scotland's energy security. The outlook for winter 16-17, following the planned closure of Longannet and a combined loss of some 5 gigawatts of coal-fired capacity across Britain, is a huge concern, given the ageing nature of much of GB's capacity and the fact that investment in new replacement baseload capacity is stalled. We have legitimate concerns for the adequacy and stability of Scotland's electricity supplies after Longannet closes, and we have made these concerns known, both to the UK government, indeed from the FM to the PM, and to the National Grid. In particular, we continue to seek reassurance that the system recovery plans, so-called black start arrangements, and the times taken to restore power supplies will be adequate following the loss of Longannet. National Grid and Scottish transmission owners are responsible for developing these plans. The Scottish Government has developed effective ways of responding to economic shocks, depending upon their nature, depending on business failure, depending upon a decision to close part of a business or particular difficulties within a sector. Usually, the Partnership Action for Continuing Employment, known as PACE, response is sufficient, complemented by business support offered through the enterprise agencies and local authorities. But in cases where the impact of the economic shock is particularly severe, Convener, greater intervention, either locally or nationally led, has been put in place. Such interventions build on the existing available PACE support as well as general economic development support through local authorities and the enterprise and skills agencies. The task force approach provides a focus to understand the challenge and impact of the economic shock and to explore all potential approaches for support and future activity. Of course, the circumstances surrounding the establishment of task force are always unique, and I think it's essential to emphasise this, that no two task forces are the same. In fact, everyone is different. And the task force enables a bespoke response, responding to the differing circumstances of each event. Where the shock is more localised, local authorities have assumed a leadership role, building effective partnership to respond to the situation in their area. I recognise the extent of the impact of the closure of Longannet will have on Fife, the neighbouring areas and across Scotland. Close partnership working with all partners is essential to ensuring successful outcomes, namely mitigating the prospect of job losses and identifying how the wider business interests can be supported. The Longannet Task Force will continue to work towards identifying the various needs and requirements prior to the closure. The emerging Longannet Economic Recovery Plan will shape that work going forward. The support we've had, I may say, moving off script from the local authority, from the company, have been exemplary. The plan that will be developed going forward will set out activities that could re-establish a fair, inclusive jobs market, replacing job opportunities lost and promoting regional cohesion in identifying an after-use for the site. The plan will look at ways to support sectoral diversification, to build skills and capitalise on the location of Longannet, the availability of strategic transport connections and local labour markets and business networks. It will also look at how to rebuild community confidence around the site. So I'm very grateful to have the opportunity to make this statement and look forward to working with the committee, both on the Longannet Task Force and on the general issue of the use of task forces. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Minister. I'm quite keen in the course of this session that we don't spend a lot of time going over a debate on energy policy. You know, we've done that many times in the past, and I think it was more important for this session is to focus on the work of the task force and how we help replace the jobs that are going to be lost and the broader question of regeneration. In that context, maybe I could just start off asking yourself, Minister, maybe Councillor Laird could come in as well. The task force has been established. Its work presumably will last for some years, I would expect. Perhaps you can elaborate on that. But how are we going to measure its success? You know, at what point are we going to look back and say, you know, is it 4 or 5 years from now? When will it be where we'll say, right, that task force was set up, it did its job, because we now have this position in Fife to replace what was lost in Longannet? How will we measure the success of the task force?
Well, I think to answer your question, Convener, I think the primary thing we have to do in the task force is to focus as a matter of urgency with our partners on what can be done in practice. The primary focus has to be on understanding the facts, understanding the nature of the problems, understanding the impacts on people and the economy, doing that as quickly as possible. Where a task force is formed, it is because there is a very severe shock, not simply a few people losing their jobs, which of course is for them a tragedy, but a very substantial impact of a sort of economically seismic nature to a local community, whether that be Glen Rothes in Fife, whether it be the steel community in Motherwell, whether it be the town of Fraserburgh, or whether it be in Longannet. But each of these is entirely different. But I think it's important to say that evaluation is something that comes afterwards. I'm sure you would agree the primary focus has to be in doing the job, especially what can be done in a practical nature. And therefore, to answer your question about evaluation, that is something that comes later. Now, I mean, I can provide it. I don't know if you want me to do so at this point, but we have, thanks to officials, got an outcome that there has been in relation to the Fife Task Force, for example, a breakdown of those who've received full-time work and training.
And Fife Task Force is for Tullis Russell.
Indeed, yeah, yes, I was just going to say that. Yeah. Well, we can't do that for Longannet because Longannet hasn't closed. I mean, one of the actual benefits of working together before the closure with the company is we can plan for what's about to happen, not after workers have received, as they did in this graceful case of the Ayrshire, the Ashley case, the USC, where workers were told and that they were being made redundant on the spot, and where the company refused to respond to our letters. By contrast, the relationship with Scottish Power has been one of very close engagement and partnership, and we've worked very closely with Hugh and his colleagues. And that, of course, is the benefit that for the workforce involved, they have got a period, I think in this case, of about 18 months to sort of prepare and plan for life beyond Longannet. A great sadness, a great shock, a great loss, but one that on a human level, thanks to the approach that this enlightened company has taken, we are able to plan much more efficaciously. And I'm very interested to hear, because I'm probably hogging the show at the moment, what my colleagues in Fife Council and also Hugh Finlay from Scottish Power say about that. I should also say that in the case of Longannet, it's not only Fife. Fife are at the greatest impacts, but I think some of the local authority colleagues would also say they are equally affected in the area as well and are represented on the task force, as you well know, a convener. But evaluation has difficulties. I mean, nobody has got a duty to come and report to Fergus Ewing, by the way, I've got a job now. A lot of people will just go on with their lives, go and get a job for themselves, and there's no duty to report. How we find out about these things is through PACE doing evaluations by sending out questionnaires to people, and that's the basis upon which statistical data is obtained about individuals. The measurement of economic impacts is much more complex because logically the exercise can only be done after a forensic, comprehensive, encyclopedic a picture of the actual benefits of Scottish Power to the supply chain, and then an analysis of what has happened to the loss of the injection of money into that supply chain. So, you know, intellectually, convener, I'm hoping to persuade you that evaluation is not an easy or simple process. We do have a method of dealing with it specifically in relation to people, and rightly so, and PACE can talk about that in a lot more detail than I can. But as to the more slightly more kind of nebulous concept of wider economic impacts, direct and indirect, you know, it is intellectually difficult to find a method of evaluation of that serious impact which does not involve, as they say, disproportionate costs. But Danny Cusack may be able to address that sort of conceptual problem in more detail if convener yourself and members wish to do so.
Well, maybe invite Councillor Laird if she wants to contribute to that question. How will we look back in 5 years' time? How will we look back and say that task force was a success?
Well, I think I would start by reiterating the point that each task force is different, and you've obviously got some experience of the Tullis Russell one. The circumstances were very different that led to that establishment. The Long Annet task force has a broader reach, not just for Fife, but actually through the Central Belt, through to the West. And clearly, therefore, the way you would approach that has got to be different. But I think in any of the task forces, we need to look very carefully at what the short, medium and long-term objectives that we're trying to accomplish out of that task force. The short-term are fairly clear in that there's a human impact, there's a job loss, and there's an impact not just at an individual level, but an impact on communities. And therefore, it's important that we, I suppose, take the mitigating actions as a task force to, first of all, address those aspects which are within our gift, within our control to actually do something about. But I think more broadly, I think you touch on a wider question, which is what are the wider ramifications when we have these sudden impacts to local economies, and how do we actually plan and assess and prepare a better, more resilient workforce actually in our communities, and a stronger economic infrastructure around which we want to take forward. So if we go to the Loch Annet task force, then there are six work streams that are effectively looking at those short, medium and long term areas. And I think it will be for, as we work through the task force, to actually then start to flesh out what we think are the medium to long term impacts. So some of those are, for example, to address areas such as lack of incubator and small business growth units within the second Carden area. So that might be something that we would want to explore further as that task force. In terms of measurement of that, then the measurement clearly needs to be further down the road about when we've managed to attract or develop or grow and sustain businesses in that. So I think it is, as the Minister says, a very complex picture. But I think you do have to have some objectives in mind, both in those timescales. And I think you have to be clear about your objective. I would reiterate that point by saying task forces take up a lot of resources, a lot of time, a lot of contributions, not from just the officials here, but actually all the people who are, you know, from these various organisations and working to try to deliver that. And we shouldn't not recognise the amount of time and effort and money that actually costs, not just to write the plan, but actually to deliver the plan. And it's the delivery that will actually test out whether we've done a good job or not in terms of our planning.
Okay, thanks for that. Mr. Cusack, did you want to comment?
Yes, if I could. I think, you know, the concept of how we do measure it is an important one, but it's also complex, as Minister and Councillor Laird have mentioned. The impacts are not just on business, it's across communities, people and businesses themselves. Now, I know that each of the agencies, we will be putting together a measurement and evaluation framework that does try to track our interventions. So in relation to Skills Development Scotland, they will be trying to track as much as possible where jobs are, people who are directly involved are redeployed, and where jobs go. From our perspective, we are looking to track all of our interventions supporting companies which either have been immediately affected or indeed are in the immediate areas. And by tracking those interventions, we can then look at how many projects have been accelerated, how many jobs have been created over time, and then through formal measurement evaluation, trying to get some sense of the collective inputs, has it mitigated effect to what we know at the moment was the effect of the economic impact, worst case scenario. So there is a framework and a government structure in place, and we will be actually taking this seriously as to look at how we intervene and is it, what the outputs of those interventions are creating.
Okay, Stephen Boyd, do you want to come in?
I think just in answer to your question about measuring success, I just think it's tremendously difficult, and I think it's quite maybe helpful to think about it instead in terms of what are expectations of task forces that are established in circumstances such as this. And I think in the first instance, it's clearly about assisting individuals who are in danger of losing their jobs. And I think in general terms, we can maybe come back to some of the specifics, but generally speaking, task forces do a reasonable job in that respect. And I think in this instance, it's certainly assisted by working with a responsible employer and having a reasonable time frame in which to deal with the issues, which is not always the case. But I think secondly, and maybe more importantly in terms of general discussion, I mean, to what extent is it reasonable to expect task forces established in these circumstances to deal with long-standing problems of economic development in many of Scotland's communities, problems which have been pretty intractable in some areas? And I think about probably the best recent example would be the coal task force established, as you know. You remember yourself the very sudden collapse of the surface mining sector in Scotland. I've attended some of those task force meetings out in Cumnock. Now, East Ayrshire has got very long-standing, deeply ingrained problems of economic development. Now, can a task force that's established in the short term in such circumstances really begin to address those problems? I'm not entirely sure that it can, and maybe what that suggests is we need a different kind of task force with a much longer-term view and outlook to start looking at those kind of issues.
Okay, thanks. There's a range of issues you've raised that are very interesting. I'm quite keen to bring in Patrick Harvey, because I know Patrick needs to leave the committee shortly. So I know you had a specific question you wanted to ask.
Well, thank you, Convener. The other committee I'm having to go to has been delayed a bit, so I've got a little longer. But the question I wanted to raise was relevant to the last point that Stephen Boyd made, so it's helpful to bring it in now. The Minister, quite rightly in his opening remarks, talked about some circumstances where we don't have foreknowledge, where we're thrown into an urgent situation and have to respond reactively. But there are situations where foreknowledge is coming. Whether, you know, there's a disagreement about whether it's, you know, necessary or not, but the Longannock plant is closing a little bit early, a few years earlier than anticipated. But it has been anticipated that this plant was coming to the end of its life for quite some considerable time. And, you know, would it not be helpful if all of that intensive activity that Councillor Laird was talking about began at a calmer pace, much, much earlier, so that we're looking at, you know, building this into the government's economic planning rather than merely being reactive when a situation like the end of burning coal for electricity has been anticipated for a long time?
Well, I'm not sure whether the phrase foreknowledge is coming is actually means anything, but I think I get the general drift. And having done so, I would refute the assertion that there was any kind of panic or unseemly rush or lack of pre-preparation. I mean, first of all, and you know, Mr. Finlay is here, and you know, he is the man that can talk about Longannock with more authority and passion than anybody else on this planet. But Longannock should not have closed. I'm answering this, Convener, because the question has been put. It should, in my opinion, have continued to do the great job it's been doing for Scotland for the last several decades, at least until the end of this decade. You have been in the convener in the boardroom, Longannock. There's a picture on the wall showing the employees. Longannock 220 is the slogan on the wall. And the professionalism and the enormous investment by Scottish Power in Longannock, which was made not in the last 20, 30 years, but in the last 10 years, I believe, was something that should have been utilised in various ways. Now, I'm not reopening the rights and wrongs of the UK government's failure to respond in any meaningful way to our repeated requests and arguments. But what I would say is that, you know, very shortly after it became evident, Convener, that, you know, the PM was not for turning, to coin a phrase, and that was going to be no intervention from the UK, and there was nothing more we could do, nothing at all. Very shortly after that, immediately after that, as far as I'm concerned, we then turned to working with our colleagues in the council and the company to address the consequences. And the very, in fact, you know, I do, you know, I think Mr. Harvey's raised a fair point in general, but I just don't think it applies to this situation. Quite the converse, actually, precisely because we have had a considerable lengthy period before the closure. The workforce have had a bit of time to think about things. We've had time to engage with Stephen and his colleagues, with Hugh, with Leslie, and we have done that in detail. And I know the company can talk about opportunities within Scottish Power for some people. Other people were fairly close to retirement. I met some of them more than once because I visited the plant several times. And others, highly skilled. My feeling was then, and I'd be interested to hear from Hugh, that an awful lot of these guys will find other jobs without a great deal of difficulty, although they would choose not so to do. So I just refute the suggestion, Mr. Harvey, utterly. And I think on the converse, we have sought to make the best of a situation that we felt very strongly should never have arisen.
Well, I certainly didn't accuse the government of panic. That's not a word that I used. But the government's own documents in energy policy have anticipated something like 2020 as the end of the operational life of the plant. And I wonder if any of the other witnesses would share the view, which Stephen Boyd seemed to be heading toward, that a longer-term piece of work for a task force like this, you know, looking at the last 10 years of the operational life of a plant like this, would give us the preparation to know that if closure was to happen a few years earlier, we've already begun a lot more of that work rather than having it take a great deal of that intensive activity that Councillor Laird was talking about retrospectively after an announcement has been made.
I think, you know, if I'm speaking from Scottish Power's point of view, and I don't want to go back into the economics. I think that's convener has been presented to this committee in the past as to why that took place. But once that decision's made, I'm not sure how you prepare for that beforehand from our point of view. My focus now is on staff and all the people we have and the people that's been impacted by this. And from a task force point of view, we met as a task force before firm commitment to close was made, and that was it's been very useful for us. It's been very useful. We've got strong engagement with the trade unions, and the position we're in as a company is as strong as it can be from that point of view and that partnership we work with. The reality of it from a staff point of view is that we, at the time we started with, there was 236 people employed by Scottish Power at Longannet. Of that, 16 have left and taking up new roles in other companies through their own way. 152 have come forward, as the Minister said, who are in a retirement position where they can take the advantage of the retirement package that is offered, which is quite substantial. And a number of them may want to go on and seek further employment going forward, but they're in a much better position than they would have been without that. And that 27 were then redeployed across our own company, across the whole business, and we have about 17% of staff who want to remain with Scottish Power, who we haven't been able to sort yet. And if I think on 17%, one is far too many, but I think on 17% being somewhere a lot south, further south than I expected at the time. So I think from our point of view and managing the people who are involved, and that's for me where the focus has to be in this right now, we're in a, you know, a good position, and we've still got some time between now and the full decommissioning of the station to try and work with the number who are left and get them work elsewhere. And in that, we've been supported by PACE. We've brought in other companies. About eight or nine companies have come in, Police Scotland, Weirs, INEOS, etc. and made presentations to staff. They've got a really skilled workforce, and so there's still opportunities. So from a people point of view, from where we are, you know, I think the timescales that we had, we have to be very sensitive to that. We've done that, and that's flowed through into a situation which we need to keep working at, but is in a pretty strong position at the moment.
Yeah, I mean, I think in these circumstances, early intervention is absolutely crucial. And I think it's interesting, these circumstances, I mean, 8 or 9 months we've had here is pretty good, actually, compared to many other instances. And I think it's interesting to think back to when PACE was established in the early part of the last decade. Now, the original intention was always that PACE would initially look at the company that was in trouble and look at various ways of saving that company, look for a new buyer, look for employee buyouts, that kind of thing, look at ways it could change the employee ownership. But that never happened. Why did that not happen? Well, because companies don't want to engage with either agencies, government, or very often, or in most circumstances perhaps, their workforce when they're coming up to a situation like that. And there's also some barriers often to them doing so. And you look at the, you know, the ownership structures in the Scottish economy, and we're very often talking about branch managers here, can hear about these kind of decisions quite far down the line. So actually, although we all agree that intervention is crucial, we've had a couple of work streams in PACE over the last few years looking at this, actually making it work in practice is really tremendously difficult, and I don't think we should underestimate that. I mean, it's something we've all been trying to make happen, as I say, for over a decade, and it's really tremendously difficult. I think I think what I was getting at, my answer to the previous question was, you know, there are apparently intractable problems of economic development, many of our communities round about Scotland, and perhaps given that, you know, there are unreasonable expectations placed on task forces established around industrial closures to perhaps begin to solve some of these problems, maybe looking at a new approach to economic development in these areas is something that would supplement the task force approach in around specific industrial closures.
Thank you.
Thanks, Convener. If I could just reinforce the point about early intervention, we are often facing in PACE situations with companies which, as the Minister said, go into administration like Tullis Russell, and we have no time. And we have a very comprehensive monitoring and evaluation programme for PACE, so we follow up every customer who receives an in-depth service. And what comes back consistently from our research is that the earlier we can get in front of employees to deliver services, the better. And I think from memory, 3 to 6 months is the optimal time for that. And certainly in the case of Scottish Power, we, as has been said, we've had very good cooperation and support from both Scottish Power and Right Management, who are their outplacement agency. And the feedback we received both from unions and employees and the company is that the timing is right in this intervention. We've been working since before Christmas with employees, and I can provide more detail on that. And in terms of the timing of support, we have enough time to do the job in hand.
Okay, thank you. Leslie.
Yeah, I would just add a couple of points. I think Stephen's point's well made about the wider economic infrastructure and what, how you respond to that. Fife Council, when there was the suggestion that Oonagh was closing, we certainly were being proactive in approaching the Scottish Government and asking for a task force to be formed, particularly off the back of the Tullis Russell announcement. We felt it was important to get on the front foot, just as you suggested, and to start where we could to make plans. But there's a balance to be struck between being premature in that and undermining business confidence. So it's a very delicate balance for politicians, I think, to try and reach. Nonetheless, it's better to be proactive than be coming in later in the day and trying to respond to issues on the ground. So it's that balance to be struck. However, I think the point, going back to Patrick Harvey's point around the wider economic assessment, I think it's really important, and I think it's the committee are raising a good question here. So if we look, for example, at the impact on the oil industry right now and the repercussions and the waves that are likely to occur from that, in Fife we've been taking stock and assessing with our manufacturing sector what will be the implications of that flow through into Fife. Because in Fife, we still have around 12% of our industry is manufacturing sector engineering led. So clearly we want to understand early what that fallout is likely to be and what if anything, we can do as a council to facilitate dialogue, opportunity for like-minded people to get together and to look at what interventions are possible. So I do think it's absolutely essential that there is this scanning of the economic horizon and actually understanding, instead of having a task force kind of coming in at the back end, well, what should we be having at the front end that's actually scanning the horizon, assessing what's coming, and actually putting the time and effort in place perhaps to some of more of that proactive economic development activity? And is it really being focused in the right areas, given some of the legacy issues that I think communities across Scotland are still having to deal with?
That's fine, thank you.
There's Robson.
Thanks, and good morning. Perhaps maybe I could address maybe Councillor Laird in the first instance, because obviously we're looking at, as you've said, being very proactive. You've got a jobs fair coming up. Is it 28th of January? Yeah, I think. How responsive have external organisations and agencies been for that job fair?
Well, I think what we've seen in Fife, really, we've got a very proactive economic development team in Fife, and our officers have very strong relationships with the business community. We are very proactive in making sure we have those relationships. So when situations like this arise, then we do have a good network of businesses that we can connect to and understand what opportunities there might be for redeployment. And that was well, I think, demonstrated through the Tullish Russell workforce. I think we also have very strong relationships with, you know, Danny and the PACE team and the trade unions. And again, I think it's the working of those relationships ongoing that actually means that when something happens, you can very quickly mobilise those resources. And I think that's been well demonstrated across the two task forces.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And you've had a good response in terms of the people that are going to come in terms of the job fair.
Well, colleagues who are organising that are probably better placed to talk specifics about that response.
Yeah, that's fair enough.
Callum McLean, you want to?
Yeah, thank you, Convener. We've gone out to Scottish Enterprise account managed companies, companies with connections to Fife Council. We've gone out through SEED, and employers are coming in. As of 2 days ago, we had approximately 12 to 15 employers, and that includes large employers such as Ineos, GSK, Scottish Water, Lockheed Martin, Weirs Engineering, and also a number of recruitment agencies. And in addition to these agencies, on the day we will also have guidance and support agencies provided through PACE.
That's very helpful. And does that match in terms of the workforce that are seeking future employment in terms of the diversity?
There's probably no quick answer to that question, because each member of the workforce is treated as an individual, yeah, and may have multiple career goals. So, for example, if you're an engineer, you may want to stay within the power generation sector. You may want to move to another sector, such as food processing engineering or defence engineering. Mm-hmm. You may wish to set up your own business. So often people have a number of career options, and we try to spread the net as widely as possible as we can. I know Scottish Power have been very proactive in linking into local employers like Ineos and GSK. So wherever there is an intention, a clear intention of a job goal from a member of staff, we will try to bring an employer to them.
Yeah, that's good. We've heard about the fact that it's an impact on, obviously, the human element for each individual and of course, their families. In each job loss, I think someone, it may have been the Minister, said it was a tragedy in itself. Have you had any engagement with the Fife Health Board in terms of offering support to individuals in terms of addressing the impact on perhaps their mental health? And maybe a question for the Minister, have you engaged with any of the banks at all to ensure that they are sympathetic to those who have maybe been made redundant or who yet have to find a future employment? So maybe the first question is to Councillor Laird, probably.
I personally haven't had contact with the health. I know that Scottish Power themselves have a strong support structure for their employees, so I would actually refer that.
Yeah, we have a very active occupational health department, so we have counsellors available to staff who want to talk to them. We have offered all staff financial advice, and we set up classes, and so right across a broad spectrum, from basics to like interviewing, preparing CVs and stuff like that to prepare people for other things, through to support, whether it be just counselling, just general chatting, or whether they want to take that further, all of that is available to every member of staff.
Minister, do you want to respond to the other point?
I think these matters are matters for the company, which they've dealt with responsibly, and for the agencies involved. I mean, my role as the convener of several task forces is to work very closely with everybody to provide overall coordination, to quickly determine what, if anything, practically can be done in a whole range of areas such as training, business growth, community regeneration, infrastructure, future use of the site, environmental mitigation. And as I think Mr. Boyd, Mr. Harvey have pointed out, I mean, each task force has a different focus. The coal task force, for example, did great work in achieving the ORR's agreement to reduce to persuade them not to hike up the costs of freight per tonne. And we did that. It wouldn't have happened, I don't think, convener, had we not questioned, I was going to say a stronger word, the ORR before the task force. If the task force hadn't been there, it wouldn't have happened. It then went on to review planning processes for restoration. The Tata task force, by contrast, has focused almost exclusively on the twin tasks of identifying a commercial operator to take over the two Scottish sites, ideally, and to make more viable that as a proposition by addressing cost issues. So you know, each task force has a different focus, and we work very closely, particularly with local authorities, as is expected, with Leslie and with David, the council convener, in the case of Fife. And, you know, if it is necessary to address particular other issues like health issues or approach banks, then we do that. But we don't start off by doing that. We start off with a really kind of focused inquiry on what the matter in hand entails and what we can usefully do. I mean, I think one of the good things to emerge pretty quickly, actually, from the task force was ScotRail recruitment of DB Schenker drivers. When it was confirmed that Longannet would close, ScotRail discussed with DBS the potential recruitment of 60 DBS rail freight drivers affected, and ScotRail advised they would welcome applications, although these would need to be assessed. And this did lead to a former DBS drivers being successful in taking up positions with ScotRail. Not many, but for every individual, that was the result. And it happened because of the kind of initial focus led to that problem. And then we went to ScotRail to see if they could help, and they were able to help. So that's a kind of example, convener, I think, of the kind of practical example that arguably could have emerged anyway, but with the task force focus and the huge work that Leslie has mentioned, perhaps it emerged sooner than it may otherwise have done.
Okay, thank you. Thank you.
I wonder if I may ask just one question, although I know we're not going back in the policy, but it was very instructive that when Amber Rudd and Stephen Lovegrove were in front of the DEC committee, that they, after Longannet closure being announced, that Stephen Lovegrove said, following the European Union's third energy package, Ofgem is effectively saying that there has to be a form of differential pricing transmission so that the generating plant is not responding to irrational economic pressures. You talk about, you know, the part of my horse getting out before the door has been closed. I wonder if I may ask Callum McLean. Last night, after about 18 months of work, I was privileged to hold a members' debate about the heavy goods vehicle driver crisis. We're short of 11,000 drivers in Scotland. And the demographics are such, and the entry position as such is that is going to impact business. Can you tell me, I mean, what regular dialogue do you have with Skills Development Scotland, or do they have with you to tell you where there are? I'm not suggesting that everybody at Long Island wants to be a lorry driver, but what ongoing discussion do you have, you know, just to keep ahead of the game in terms of what they perceive to be a shortage in particular industries?
I know that colleagues within SDS who have responsibility for specific sectors have regular dialogue with the heavy goods associations. I don't have the detail of that.
Heavy goods. I mean, that happens to be the case in point.
But, yeah.
You know, surely we should be ahead of the game.
Yep.
And I'm not laying that at your job.
Sure, of course.
We should be ahead of the game in terms of indicating what the demand is.
Yep. In terms of the dialogue with the HGV and other sectors, we have a team of sector managers whose job it is to engage with industry, to have a forward look at industry needs and to articulate them through skills investment plans. And that's fed down into our one-to-one guidance process, which is there to support everyone who is under threat of redundancy. And in this case, we're advising not only Longannet, but also a number of supply chain companies and everyone who is in the position of being under threat of redundancy is offered one-to-one consultations and the opportunity to identify training which might meet their needs and assist them to get a job in the labour market. And that would include HGV training, bus driving training, etc., etc. And for each...
The knock-on effect, I may talk to Mr. Cusick, is that we talk about food and drink, particularly exports. You know, getting HGV drivers to take Seaford and Drew McAlpin helped in the debate last night. Getting drivers to take our exports to whatever port of exit there is extremely difficult. And you know, as I said, not everybody wants to be a lorry driver, but it's a highly paid job. And I'm just surprised that there seems to be no mention of that when I talk to and have talked to those that lead the industry.
Well, the HGV industry. I'll certainly report back with the discussions that colleagues have had, but in terms of every individual, a discussion about training options is on the table, and that's certainly one of the things we would discuss with them.
Thank you.
To give you some reassurance, there are well-developed dialogue across the skills agenda, across all our key sectors. So there are skills development plans, as Callum alluded to. So in food and drink, there is a team looking from Skills Development Scotland and from industry looking at...
That's not the case, because we had to drag them to the table to put out a survey, which closes today, to put out a tender... To do a full survey on the HGV market. So they haven't been at the table.
But perhaps they, on the logistics side of it, not, but certainly from the immediate skills required for the industry, then that is a focus which looks at the industry requirements. It also then takes that through to both training schools and further education. So, okay.
Thank you.
Can I just raise a related point about this, convener, which is that one of the many benefits, as Mr. Boyd, Mr. Finlay have said, about having a bit of time, is that, you know, if any of the workforce involved in any of the areas where there's a severe shock or any worker has 18 months or a year to decide what he or she wants to do, then if the plans include going back to college or university, then that time can be used to make an application to get on a course. If you don't hear until the day before that you're being made sacked, you're being sacked, then of course the next available course that you want to do might not start for 6 or 9 months or a year hence. So that, you know, we work, and I should have said this initially, I apologise, the colleges and the universities, we work extremely closely with, as appropriate. And we've had great support in Fife in particular, I think, who've risen to the challenge. I've got, a table showing the number of workforce in Tullis Russell that did decide to pursue various diverse types of training. But, you know, where there is more notice, then on a human level, there's a bit of time for planning, and somebody can think, I fancy doing something entirely different. I'll just go back to college or university. That's much easier to do in a Longannet Scottish Power process than it is where the workforce here the day before that they're getting their P45.
Councillor Laird, do you want to come in?
I would actually probably reflect Mr. Brodie's point fairly accurately. I mean, in Fife, we took a view very early in our administration that we needed to have a more accurate assessment of matching skills with training. We undertook, therefore, a partnership study with Professor Alan McGregor of Glasgow University to actually assess more accurately what the demands were and what the skills requirements were. And what we've been basically implementing over the last few years is an alignment of that plan. So we are making sure, for example, that the Fife economy is focused around delivering the skills that the businesses in Fife and beyond need, because we do need to recognise it is a global market and not become too parochial in our skill set. So it's also about understanding, therefore, the relationships between education and the colleges and to making sure that that pipeline is working effectively. So it's not a simple case. I think it comes back to my earlier point. If you're not regularly scanning the horizon and understanding what's changing, then you're going to obviously not be connected by how things are changing in the market. And I think that's what we're attempting to do in Fife. But I think from some of the examples we've discussed today, you can see it's a very dynamic picture. And it's changing all the time. And I suppose my question to the committee is, how do we get better mechanisms that are being more proactive in scanning that market and that we're actually ahead of the game and not catching up?
What surprises me is, I mean, I think the government and the minister's doing, and the leaders of industry and the trade unions are doing the best job they can in the circumstance. What I don't understand is why each of the councils, and you can tell me why I'm wrong, each of the councils don't have an a priori list of their major employers and regularly meet with them. They may do. Regularly meet with them to see what their financial situation is, what the market conditions are, employment conditions. That doesn't seem to be happening in the economic development teams, certainly in some of the councils I've talked to.
Well, I think you have to look at it in the context of what's been happening more widely in local government. I mean, there's been 40-odd thousand job losses. If you're protecting frontline services, that quite often means that things like economic development are one of those areas that unfortunately get targeted. I'm pleased to say in Fife that's not the case. So we are proactive. We have a register of our top 250 companies. We regularly dialogue and meet. We have officers who are matched to those companies, so we have a kind of relationship management basis. I regularly go out and meet businesses. I hold different forums with cross-sections of the business community in Fife. So it's about having the time and the resources, but it's also about having the strategy and the plan that says that you're very clear about what you're trying to achieve. I come back to my earlier points. What's your short, medium and long-term objectives and how are you delivering those on the ground? And that's what we're attempting to do in Fife.
Yes, I know. I ran a company in Fife and I know how well Fife does it.
Okay.
Just saying,
across the board.
Yeah, if I can maybe just add to that from a Scottish enterprise perspective across our portfolio of 2,500 companies at any one time, each of those do have a actually dedicated account manager, so that dialogue is happening on an ongoing basis. And in relation to the immediate Longannet, then there are 189 account managed companies across the immediate area of Fife, Clackmannanshire and Falkirk, and that dialogue is continually ongoing to understand these requirements and also to identify where we can actually accelerate or support growth projects.
I think it's important just to make a couple of general points that backing up really what Councillor Laird and Danny Cusack have made, that there is ongoing work entirely apart from task forces. The bread and butter work of the Enterprise Network of Business Gateway. I mean, Business Gateway have assisted 801 new start businesses in Fife. Danny was beat me to it to refer to the companies we're working as account managed companies. In 2015 to date, five RSA projects have been approved in Fife, totalling £540,000 in the creation of 39 jobs. I mean, most of this work, conveners, as I think you well know, goes on under the radar, behind the scenes. Because it's good news, it's not really featuring very much in the press prints, and the people involved know about it, but it doesn't really hit the headlines. And secondly, there's an entirely separate area of work where we work with the enterprise network, with local authorities, but also with insolvency petitioners, early intervention, to get, if you like, advanced confidential forewarning of potential industrial difficulties in companies. A lot of the work that I'm involved with relates to that confidential work. And the relationships we've built up with ICAS, with insolvency petitioners, allows us in confidence to try to address difficulties behind the scenes. In some cases, averting administration. In some cases, looking post-administration at how the business, if it is viable and profitable or could be made such, could be continued. So there's a whole range of other work, aside from task forces, is the point I'm making, which we try to do to the best of our ability. The last point I make is that I'm aware that Fife Economic Team are extremely proactive. They hold business breakfasts. Both myself, John Swinney, have attended them. I visited a number of companies recently and frequently, Oceaneering, FMC, Bifab, Raytheon, and many others in Fife, who are all major employers in Fife. All have different challenges and successes. But, this work carries on and is the staple of economic development work in Scotland, working together to try to achieve sustainable economic growth and assist people to get and keep their jobs.
When you want to come in.
I just need to be very careful about understanding skills gaps, shortages and mismatches as a consequence of agencies and local authorities not doing their jobs properly. I mean, if, for instance, the road haulage industry is facing a skill shortage on that scale, then in the first instance, the road haulage industry has to have a good hard look at itself. And secondly, the Long Annet closure is not a secret to anyone. Yeah, that's good, you know, but I mean, the Long Annet closure isn't a secret to anybody now. There's a reservoir of skilled people there to be drawn on, so the HGV industry should be right in about it. I mean, Callum and his colleagues have organised these jobs fairs. They can't approach every employer or every industrial sector to be involved in that. I mean, they should be making themselves aware of these opportunities and making the most of them.
Okay. Lewis McDonald.
Thank you very much. And, it's been a very interesting session so far. I am also a member of a task force in Fraserburgh with very different challenges and in some ways steeper challenges in relation to people, because I think what Hugh Finlay has said about the people position is perhaps more encouraging than I think he himself anticipated at the beginning. The focus on people is absolutely right. I'm interested though in the other aspect of this issue, which is the impact on community, because clearly in an area, in a case like this, where there's been a high number of highly skilled and well-paid jobs in technical areas, and that suddenly disappears, that has an impact on all the individuals, but it must also have an impact on Kincardine and the immediate vicinity. I wonder if members of the task force could comment on that. And going back to Stephen Boyd's point at the very outset, that there was a time when the first question Pace would have asked was whether there was an alternative operator. Clearly, these are not the same circumstances that might have applied 15 years ago, but nonetheless, the site itself is clearly of value in itself. And again, I'd be interested in what can be said today about the disposal of the site and how that might be connected to economic development for that local community.
I think if I just pick up initially on the site, I think we need to be, just to make people aware, we'll close the station the 31st of March. We then have sort of 9 months of decommissioning and making safe the situation that's there. At that point, even if a decision was made to demolish the building starting on the 1st of January 2017, you've got 4 years then to get that. It's a substantial piece of work to bring it down. So from now, we're broadly 5 years before the site would be in any meaningful way available to do things. Now, that doesn't stop us, as we've mentioned and discussed in the task force and other offshoots from that, the ability to look at any suggestions for the site that are doable, where we can work together. Scottish is one is a sort of business which is on the site at the moment, and we're able to manage things that they can remain there and continue doing what they're doing. So we're always open to doing that, but there is a 5-year period to get, and that's if a decision's made and nothing else changes in that time, that we went from now straight through the process before the site would be levelled in a similar position to the one at Kikenzie, for instance.
That's helpful. I wonder from perhaps the local authority point of view, the impact on the immediate neighbourhood of the loss of these jobs. Clearly, many of the people involved are at the point of taking early retirement or otherwise being redeployed, but there must also be a community impact.
I would just make a couple of points. The two task forces that we've had set up, the two companies were actually had very highly skilled workers. And in Scottish Power's case, very well trained workers who had ongoing training and support and regularly were upgrading their skills. So in terms of their marketability when this event happened, they clearly had a skill set that made them attractive to other businesses, and you can see that from the companies that have come into response. I think in terms of the question I think more for me is, how do we build resilient and sustainable communities going forward? And I think that is really part of the work that I think we need to look at more broadly. So how do we make sure that our education system is fit for purpose, and that it's not just about education, but building people who are resilient, communities that are able to see that wider economic horizon and understand what that means to them and the skills and that they need for themselves to actually continue to keep them marketable and relevant to what's happening. And I think for me, the bit that plays a key part of that is obviously the role of colleges. So regrettably, we have seen at a time when we would want to have more people skilled and going into opportunities to have skills refreshed and updated, then the college sector has perhaps, for various reasons, lost that pivotal role that I think the college sector has played through the years. And therefore, if we're really looking at wider economic impact, we need to understand all the levers that contribute to actually making people resilient in both of their skills and in terms of their outlook. And I think if we do that for communities, then we stand a better chance. We operate in a global environment. Lots of companies are competing for investment. Lots of companies are competing for skills. We need to make sure that we stand out, and that starts with putting the right skills with our people in our communities.
Thank you very much.
And perhaps if I could just add, just to reflect the importance of both the community and also the site, there are, as maybe Councillor Laird alluded to at the beginning, there are very specific and separate strands within the action plan that she's focusing specifically on both those aspects.
Just if I can follow up this point about the site, I think it's actually quite important, because it seems to me there's almost kind of two routes that a task force can go down. One is to say, right, we've got a workforce, we've got a skill base, and we'll try and disperse those and find them on other employment elsewhere. And some people will take retirement, and some people will go to other jobs elsewhere. And the alternative route might be to say, as I think was attempted at Tullis Russell, without a great deal of success, I think, trying to find another enterprise that could come in and occupy the site and take up some of the employment. I'm interested to get any thoughts on that. I mean, the only enterprise I was aware of who had any prospects in the area in terms of skilled employment were Clough Natural Resources, to come in with their proposal for underground coal gasification in the Forth, which I know Fife Council were not very enthusiastic about, and they pulled out because a lack of political support and policy certainty from Scottish Government. But should we not be more welcoming of this sort of initiative that could bring in skilled jobs to the area?
Well, Fife Council can speak for itself, but I mean, I think, you know, conceptually, first, I don't think those are the two possibilities, disperse or get kind of inward investment. Quite the contrary, actually. I mean, my approach in convening task forces throughout the country is based on the essential need to try to engage with the local businesses that are there already, because those that are doing well are able to assist taking on one, two, three or more jobs, and they all want to help. They want to be asked to contribute. That's why in Hoyk we'll be holding an event for local businesses there and Ent in a couple of weeks' time. That's why in Fraserburgh I held one, I think was it last week, the week before, last Monday, for local businesses, and that led on to two potential actions. So by reaching out to local businesses, very often you learn things that are current, you learn about their plans that perhaps they could bring forward, you learn about potential vacancies, which, you know, in the case of Fraserburgh, may be assisted by the provision of a local bus service from Fraserburgh to an area not far from Fraserburgh, but where many of the workers do not have cars and there is no bus service. So the approach is to find out the facts locally. Yes, of course, an alternative use of the site is something that is appropriate in some task forces. Yes, of course, inward investment is the answer. But, you know, whether it's Diageo or Vion or Freshlink or Fraserburgh or Fife or Longannet, we need to reach out to local businesses, as well as having the task force, which is a largely public sector event. We also need to have events to reach out to the business community, the local business community. And, you know, I can absolutely assure you, Convener, that many local businesses in Fife really have risen to the occasion. And incidentally, I think I'm right in saying that Marine Harvest have decided to locate a new plant very recently in Glenrothes in order to conduct a fish processing activity there. So, you know, so it's not correct to say that Fife is a no-go area and in investment either, but that is not necessarily the primary approach to take. And also by its nature, inward investment plans are a long time in the fruition. You know, I'm involved in innumerable projects at the moment that may or may not come to fruition. What they all have in common, particularly the larger ones, is that they take years, not months, to deliver. And therefore, the efficacy from a task force point of view is less good than reaching out to the local business community and the workforce representatives and engaging intensely with them straight away.
But Minister, is it not a source of regret that the prospect of many hundreds, if not thousands, of skilled jobs from the proposal from Clough Natural Resources has at best been put on the back burner for the time being?
Well, that's something that, you know, I thought we didn't want to debate larger, wider energy issues today, Convener. That's your admonition at the beginning, so I didn't...
Well, it was a specific proposal to create jobs in the vicinity of
In several years' time. You see, that's where I'm afraid, with respect, I think you're wrong. Because, you know, let's assume that you're correct and that project should proceed. And you know, we have made our position fairly clear on the moratorium issue on underground coal gasification and on hydraulic fracturing. And that's our position, which I won't rehearse right now because I think it's very well known. But even were the projects to proceed, those jobs and opportunities wouldn't actually emerge and arrive for several years to come. What we need to do in a task force situation, as I think you said a moment ago, is deal with the immediate shock to communities, individuals and companies. That, if you like, is one of the purposes of task force. The issue of wider energy issues are, I think, as Mr. Boyd indicated, wider economic and energy policy issues, which is quite right that we debate, but they're just not the focus of what we do in the task force world.
Okay. Councillor Laird, do you want to say anything?
I think, first of all, Fife is absolutely open for business and absolutely open for high-quality jobs, and I think that's already demonstrated by some of the employers that we've been talking about today. But looking ahead, which is what we're trying to do and be proactive, that's why we're investing in the Fife Energy Park, because we have ambitions for Fife. You know, we've got a number of key projects already emerging and developing there, all of which take time to nurture and bring forward. But I think the key point that we have to address here is the balance between attracting inward investment and actually growing our own Indigenous businesses and making sure we've got the right infrastructures and skills and workforce in place to actually help and support those. So if we come to the Longannet Task Force, I mean, one of the areas that we've recognised is that there's not enough small incubator growth units within that area. So it's not just about addressing the problems that we have emerging out of the Longannet. It's actually looking more broadly and saying, well, how do we actually make sure the economy is set up better for the future? And I think it's taking the opportunity through the task force to do that. So going back to your point about Clough Resources. We had dialogue, yes, with Clough Resources, our planners did, but I'm not aware that we had anything specific proposal. But as a council, we have to balance the needs of business along with the environmental concerns of the community. And until you've matched all of those parts up, it would be premature, I think, to be welcoming anyone without doing due diligence in the first place.
Stephen Boyne.
Yeah, I would agree with the Minister that the choice presented in your original question, Convener, is perhaps not as quite stark as it came across in your question. I also agree with the Minister that the work of the task forces can be tremendously helpful in understanding local supply chains and understanding the nature of the local economy. But I mean, I'm concerned about what we've been dealing with in Scotland over the last year and the number of losses of large-scale workplaces in the productive sector and what this means for both national and local economic resilience. And Leslie used the word resilience, and I think it's a good way of positing the questions we're dealing with here. And I think unless we do manage to replace that kind of industrial capacity, then local economies will suffer. Because I mean, I think one of the lessons of Longannet is, you know, it's brought home in very stark terms the scale of the local supply chain and the nature of that local supply chain. And it's all very well and good, and of course we should be doing all we can to nurture local small businesses, but local small businesses rely on large-scale productive workplaces to support local demand, to support local supply chains. And unless we manage to replace that scale of workplace, then I do have concerns about what some of or the trajectory that some of our local regional economies are on at this moment in time.
Okay, thank you. Sorry, somebody was... Yeah, Danny, it was you.
It was, just to add to both Councillor Laird and Stephen's comments, it is about kind of looking at both strands and building the capacity and capability of our companies already in the area and trying to make them as internationally competitive as possible. But also at the same time pursuing where we have real opportunities from the point of view of strategic assets or propositions to see what other companies, whether they're in the other parts of the UK or other parts of the world, that we can attract to Fife and to other parts of Scotland. And those strategies are happening. They are complex and they are difficult, and as Minister alluded to, do take an enormous amount of time. But that does not prevent us looking to where we can actually promote and sell Scotland as a viable place to do business. And as we know, our track record on this has been second to none. We are able to, outside of London, attract the most inward investment of any other region of the UK. And we have done that several years in a row. So that focus will not diminish and will still be very much part of our ongoing plans.
Okay, we are at the end of our time. If there are no more members who are desperate to ask a final question, I think we can draw a line under it there. Can I thank you on behalf of the committee for coming along this meeting? I think an extremely helpful and useful session to the committee in terms of understanding the work of the task force, and clearly we wish you well in your endeavours. And at this point, we will suspend briefly and go into private session.